From Geppetto Studios in New Freedom, Pennsylvania, welcome to the Cosmic Geppetto Podcast, your home for inclusive, positive geek culture, where we talk about movies, comics, music, books, and whatever else we feel like. Please welcome your host.
People aren't going to realize how wonderful he is, probably for another 10 years.
Brad Mendenhall.
Hey kids, it is episode 215 of the Cosmic Geppetto Podcast. It is a good one, as friend of the show Scott Carelli returns to talk about dueling genres, Geek by Night. Scott has been part of the fun for years. He's a great guy who always brings his A game. Anywho, Katie has a question.
If you could own any prop from a movie or TV show, what would it be?
That's a great question because I am not a big, there's so many YouTube geek-centric shows that you watch where you have the presenter with like a whole background just filled with art and bobbleheads and action figures and stuff, and I have none of that stuff. I'm looking around my area, and I have a stuffed otter and one of my kids' Baymax toys from Giga Hero 6, and it's not mine. It's my kids just like that movie, which, by the way, was a pretty good movie. But anyway, if I were to have one thing, I think it'd be the, like, I don't know if it's a sawed-off rifle or this really nifty gun from that was used in the excellent, very campy, very fun Bruce Campbell show produced by Sam Raimi, The Adventures of Briscoe County Jr., which was a really fun show. And then that same weapon ended up being used in the TV show Firefly. Zoe, the first mate, the second in command of the ship, she ended up using the same gun because Joss Whedon, my understanding, was also a fan of the show. So it's just neat, like, one prop used in two culty shows that didn't get nearly the love they deserved and didn't get the second season they either deserved when they were there. So it's really a cursed item. Any show where that pops up, that prop pops up, is not going to do well. And I'm not a gun guy. True story, I have never held or fired any sort of firearm, but just the aesthetics of this rifle are very cool. So yeah, that'd be it. Hello. My dog decided to just put his head under my arm. So, how's Cannoli?
She's good. She was in a donut for a little while because she had an eye infection, but she's back to normal now. You know, running around the house like a maniac because she's only 6 months old.
Yeah, that's what cats do. So, Scott, how are you doing?
Good. I actually think about the last episode that I was on a lot and about how, like, most of those movies haven't come out.
Yeah, all I have to do is a rerun next summer.
Yeah. Just take out the section on Wonder Woman and everything else will stay the same.
And I was so proud of myself because we have a handful of episodes that we do that we do every year. So it's Oscar episode with Jessa and Murren. We do a Halloween episode with the Pele Media folk. You and I, every year, we do our summer movie episode. And it's always a great conversation, and it's always like a good length conversation, so it requires a little extra editing. Sometimes I don't start talking. We don't set it up until way too soon before, or way too close to when summer movies start. And I was like really proud of myself. Like, I think we did in like February.
Yeah.
I was like, this will be fantastic. This is going to be great. And then every week, I was like, oh, no. What's going to happen? Because so many movies have been pushed back, but movies are eventually still going to start getting made again. Is there just going to be a big glut of movies in this summer?
I don't know, because what I find interesting is that, you know, they started making movies again like 2 or 3 months ago. They started, you know, with like COVID restrictions. Now they're just banking movies. Like, movies are finishing under COVID restrictions, and there's still all the movies that haven't come out yet. And now there's movies being completed that can't come out until the other movies come out. Like, they just made Scream 5. A movie that, if you've seen any of those movies, there's not any special effects in those movies, you know? Like, they probably, at worst, they just need to, like, spend some time in an edit bay and throw the movie together. And they just finished it, and it's not coming out until, I think, January or February of 2022, which is so far away. But they don't have any other choice because there's so many movies sort of backed up, you know. It's like when you get like a bunch of planes at the airport, your pilot is like, yeah, we're just gonna have to kind of do circles above the airport until they let us land. And that's kind of what it seems like is happening.
And it feels like the Scream stuff has happened so quick. It doesn't feel like it was that long ago that they announced it. That's a franchise that feels a little out of gas or in need of a shakeup, because the last movie didn't do well. And then wasn't there a TV show?
Yeah, there was a TV show, but it was weird because the first two, there was two seasons and then a Halloween special or something that were one continuity. And then the third season was on a different network with back, I think, in the original continuity, but had nothing to do with those movies other than the ghost face looked like the ghost face in the movies instead of a new ghost face that they were using in the other show. It was extremely confusing, and the show was not good.
I enjoyed the Scream movies, obviously with different movies, different amounts.
Sure.
They're continuing the original movies, and we'll see. And they were able to get Courtney Cox and David Arquette.
Neve Campbell.
All the surviving players to come back, so good for them.
It's the writer directors of Ready or Not, which was an excellent horror movie if you haven't seen it. And horror movie in terms of, like, yeah, I guess that's technically the genre, but it's like it's got a big sense of humor to it, so it's like a really fun watch. It has more in common with something like Cabin in the Woods than it does with a regular horror movie. And so I think they're going to be really good. They're a really good pick for taking that that franchise and rebooting it or legacy sequeling it or whatever it is that they're doing.
Did Craven do the fourth one?
Yeah. Craven and returning writer Kevin Williamson, who wrote one and two, but couldn't write three, which is why three is such a massive, you know, quality downturn. It's written by Aaron Kruger, who wrote such films as Reindeer Games and the second Transformers movie.
Wait a minute. The second Transformers movie had a writer?
I know. It surprises me too, but his name is Aaron Kruger, and he wrote Scream 3.
Don't get me wrong. The problem with the Transformers movies were not the writers. The problem came from other places, but still.
Well, I don't know. The writing didn't help.
No, but... you know, the first... Michael Bay.
The second one had Robot Heaven.
I was a perfect age group for the Transformers movies because I remember going home and seeing the original cartoon on after school. And I actually saw the 1984 animated Transformers movie in theaters. I wanted the movies to be good. And seeing the first one, and it was sort of like nostalgia lenses, where it's like I was convincing myself, it's like, no, this isn't that bad. This isn't that bad. And then each movie just got so atrocious. And then Bumblebee was pretty good.
Yeah, Bumblebee was great. I love Bumblebee. I wish they had all been at that level of quality.
I hate trashing Michael Bay because I understand what he does.
Sure.
He's a director that really, I think, needs a whole lot of oversight.
I mean, the grosses on those movies tend to prove otherwise. As much as they're not good, people see all of them. Apparently multiple times if the receipts or any indication.
It's so hard to argue with success, and in movies, success is everyone wants to win Oscars and get great reviews, but it's making more money than the movie costs. It's a very different thing, but people keep talking about how Captain Marvel in the Marvel Cinematic Universe was such a failure, or how they're going to go in direction, or it's viewed as this. And I was like, it made so much money.
Yeah, it did.
There's just a segment of fandom that gets hurt about stuff, and they want it to be a unsuccessful movie. It's like, no, it made just a lot of money. So, and that's what movies are supposed to do.
Yep, definitely.
course, is not what we're going to be talking about, but it's too valuable to have you here not to bring it up. You mentioned already. So Wonder Woman, it will be released in theaters, but it's going to be released on HBO Max the same day.
Yeah, Christmas Day. Along with Soul on Disney Plus, the new Pixar movie.
Is that going to be in theaters? I didn't even know if that was going to be in theaters, Soul.
No, it's not. It's just going to be Disney Plus, but still, new Pixar movie. It's going to be a good Christmas for movies.
It's going to be a very good Christmas. My kids will be very happy. It didn't feel like Soul had a lot of buzz, but that could have just been because they didn't have a chance to start the advertising for it.
Yeah, they definitely did it because Onward was still in theaters when everything shut down. They weren't done marketing Onward. They couldn't move on to Soul yet.
Specifically with Wonder Woman, and I'm sure they wanted to wait for that to get into theaters until the world became normal, because as much love as there was for the first Wonder Woman film, and this one looks good. It'll be interesting to see, although I think we're starting to get an idea of how they're going to bring Chris Pine back for the movie, which was very surprising when everyone found that out. But I mean, people are primed to really like this movie, and it was going to make a lot of money if it had been released. But I'm interested to see how they're going to measure the success of that, because it's weird when these movies come out via streaming services as well as theater. So it's not going to make as much money. It wasn't going to anyway, because we're still in the middle of the global bastard, as I've heard it referred to. From your perspective, how do they measure success on that? Is it increased buzz? Is it increased signups for the HBO service?
I'm sure the second thing is a large part of it. I foresee them announcing some sort of, sign up to see Wonder Woman and like pay like some amount to get it for like all year. I'm assuming they're going to do some kind of deal like that. Kind of like what they did with Disney Plus. Because I think that would be a really good way to measure the success of it. Ultimately, the success of it is sort of irrelevant, because like the reason they're doing it is because Trump lost the election. If this movie were to come out in theaters post Biden's inauguration, the satire in the film is going to play as stale, because the person that they're satirizing is no longer in power.
Oh, so the Pedro Pascal character?
Right, right. My understanding is that's the reason, is that the movie would feel dated and stale on January 21st, which is like, oh yeah, I guess that's something that they probably didn't even consider when they were making the movie. It's just like, oh yeah, we're making something that's going to come out, you know, the year of the election. It's going to be the perfect time for a movie satirizing that guy. This is going to be great. And then I think that's why they kept pushing to get it open. Like, I think Wonder Woman had more release dates than any other movie this year. In terms of like, it just moving back like a couple of weeks, it might even have more than Tenet at this point, because Tenet eventually just gave up and opened. I think that like, they just kept pushing it back, like only like a few weeks, hoping things would get better. And then I think they plugged in that Christmas date because they were like, well, this is the last straw, right? And then if you notice, they didn't announce that it was going to hit HBO Max until after Trump lost. And then once Trump lost, they were like, okay, we have to now. Which is weird to think that if Trump had won, Wonder Woman probably would have been released in theaters next year. It's a very strange situation.
It's a mad world.
Right, right. That's my understanding, is that it had to do with the movie not feeling fresh in Biden presidency.
Yeah, I've become over the last year a big Pedro Pascal fan, and he's one of those actors who's been around forever, doing his best in pretty bad movies. Just yesterday, I was flipping through the channels and I saw the second Kingsman movie. He was fine, but that movie was so bad. Such a disappointment.
Yeah, it was a massive disappointment. That first movie was really good, and that second one was rough.
And it should have been. It wasn't like the second Kick-Ass drop in quality, where it's like, okay, well, it didn't have the same creatives behind it or anything. It was still, it's like, what happened here?
Well, it actually reminds me exactly of what happened to Men in Black, where Men in Black is like this perfect film, but the problem was that when they tried to make a sequel, any version of the sequel, the studio wouldn't greenlight, because they're like, we don't care about Will Smith and anyone else. We want Will Smith and his mentor. We want J&K. And if we're not going to get J&K, we're not going to greenlight a sequel. And so they're like, but Kay retired. Like, that was the whole point of the movie. And they're like, we don't care. Pull him out of retirement. So they had to come up with some dumb plot reason for him to be pulled out of retirement so he could become Kay again so that they can make a sequel that wasn't very good. And I think that that's very similar to what happened in Kingsman.
It made me crazy because you're exactly right. They brought back
Colin Firth.
Colin Firth really reaches, like, he got shot in the eye.
Yeah.
And then also frustrated me that they end up killing off a bunch of other characters as well. It's like, quit it. And I know they're doing a prequel to that, The King's Man.
Right. Which looks okay. Hopefully it's not as like cartoony as the second one was. It looks like it's more in tone with the first one, the best I can tell from the trailers. So fingers crossed, that's good. And apparently he's going to make a third one after that, a third like proper one. We'll see how it goes.
This is all awesome. I'm sure we're going to go off track a couple times, but I just listened to the most recent episode of Geek by Night. Aside from the fact that Dueling Genre, everything you guys do was always excellent and top quality, I'm listening to your show with new ears now because Geppetto Studios, in conjunction with Ovation Dinner Theater, we're doing our own little weekly play. Say yes. Boy, it gives me a new appreciation of how damn good Geek by Night is. our little show, it's once a week, and it's 3-minute episodes, and 2-3 actors at most in each episode, and there's an intro music, and there's the outro music, and sometimes a little bit of sound effects. And you guys do so damn much with so many people, and the music is excellent, the sound effects are fantastic, the editing, everything else is put together. And it's so good. It's amazing how well you guys do at moving the chess pieces around and finding the quality vocal talent, because people don't understand how hard it is to cast something like that. And you have a big darn cast and making sure everyone has their own voice and that, you know, all the men don't sound all alike and all the women. And that has to be done by both casting the talent and also the writing. And the writing's so sharp and so funny, but still can be affecting. But you have to make sure that not all the characters sound alike. And I'm just really impressed by that. And doubly so now that I've done my own, that we're doing our own little version of that. It's like, holy crap, this is so hard. And you guys make it sound, are doing something so much more inherently difficult and make it seem so effortless.
Well, thank you. I'm glad that it sounds effortless because it certainly is not.
No, it's what's the expression? It's work like this, it's like a duck where everything looks serene above water and underneath it's paddling like hell.
Yeah, right. I've never heard that expression. That's fun.
You know, whenever you do anything in entertainment, that's what everything is. Working really, really, really hard to make it sound very easy, which also irritates me because so many times entertainment produces a thing of, hey, we're going to put on the show. And they throw together the show while driving to the venue. And it's this amazing Broadway quality production. It's like, that's why people think this crap's so easy, because we're encouraging them to believe that.
I assume part of it is because they want to keep the mystery of it alive. But at the same time, yeah, no, you're just making everybody respect us less.
Give everybody a recap on what Geek by Night is, because you've had, 30 some episodes now?
Our 35th episode just came out. The one you're referencing is our 35th episode. Our 36th, which is our mid-season finale, will air on Sunday the 13th. And then we'll be taking a little break until next year, where we'll come back with our final batch of episodes.
Final,
yep.
Before we get to that, because that was something I was going to ask, just give our listeners a recap or a thumbnail of what Geek by Night is.
Yeah, so Geek by Night is an original podcast drama. I believe, you know, they used to call them radio plays, then they called them podcast series, and now I think they call them scripted narrative podcasts. They keep changing the name because I don't know why. This is a scripted narrative show that I created and executive produce with my writing partner, Nick Jimenez, and Cassandra Fredrickson. It is a series about comic book geeks who are friends that get superpowers and go on a journey of coming of age from their 20s into their 30s, figuring out how to be adults while also figuring out this superpower thing and deciding if they want to be superheroes or what. It's largely a show about geek culture. All of that other stuff is used for, you know, plot and story reasons. But really, the reason that I write this show and the reason that I chose these characters to tell this story is so that I could do a show about geek culture and the way that geeks interact with each other. It's not like the Big Bang Theory. We're all real people who like this stuff. And I wanted to make a show that was sort of like the anti-Big Bang Theory. And that's sort of like how I picture this show.
All through the night, I'll be awake and I'll be with you. All through the night, this precious time, when time is new.
I once heard Big Bang Theory described as a show about geeks written by the people who don't understand geeks.
Yeah, it's a show about geeks written by jocks. That's what it is. Yeah, this is a show about geeks written by geeks for geeks, and about geek culture.
I don't want to take too much of a shot against Big Bang Theory. It was what it was, and something where your parents or your in-laws or your aunt and uncle get a laugh out of it because it's definitely humor for them, but it's not humor for the people that the show is about.
No, it's a show that's making fun of them so that other people laugh at them rather than a show about geeks like laughing with each other.
Has there been a TV show that you've ever seen that did that right? That did a show about people who are into this world and minds the laughs with some respect?
There's not a lot, honestly. There's not a lot. Freaks and Geeks comes to mind, but it's not the main focus of the show. Yeah, I don't know. There's not a lot of options in terms of that. And that's kind of part of the problem. I contend that Revenge of the Nerds ruined everything. Because of that movie, everyone got a mental image in their mind of what a nerd or a geek was. And it's sort of never evolved.
And it's crazy because the respect for and the love of Star Wars, Marvel movies and comic book movies make up most movies, it feels like now. Weird that nobody has figured out a way to do a, here are the jokes that are there, and there's plenty to have it, because I think people who are involved in this world will be the first one to admit, it's like, oh, we get way too passionate about it, we get a little silly, and we realize the ridiculousness of it, but it's also, at its best, a really fun and inclusive group, and a great variety of people, and it's not all just comic book guy from The Simpsons.
Exactly.
For Geek by Night, what's the most challenging thing to do? What's the part that makes you tear your hair out the most?
Probably breaking story for each episode. I'm kind of a perfectionist I'm a perfectionist about pretty much everything with the show. The scripts I take a lot of pride in, and when I have an idea for an episode and I just can't get it to work, I'm actually in the midst of that right now. An upcoming episode from next year. It drives me crazy because I will just be, you know, it looks like I'm not doing anything, but it's like constantly gnawing at me in the back of my head while I'm like doing other things. Just this sort of like heavy burden of knowing I need to write this script, knowing also that I haven't gotten it to work yet.
And especially with the format you're doing where you need each episode to have its beginning, middle, and end, and it's cliffhanger, and the challenge of something that's serialized that you have your end game for, but still the episodes have to stand on their own and be entertaining and engaging on their own. We had Bob Kester on, who was the force behind Immunities, which I know is another dueling genre production. Something that he and I talked about is between Say Yes and also the scripted stuff that we've done, the skits that we've done for Cosmic Geppetto, the thing that always makes me nuts is getting the vocal talent together. We literally have people on different continents acting against each other, and it's not always easy to do between differences of sound quality or whatever have you. For Geek by Night, how do you pull together the vocal talent? Are you lucky to get some people in the same room or?
Never, not once. Well, the way the process works is we write a script, we release it to the actors, and then we schedule a table reading over Zoom with those actors. It used to be Google Hangouts, now it's Zoom. We do a table reading, and that's when I will, or the director of that episode will give direction on performance and things like that, notes and whatnot. But we'll go all the way through the script so that everybody gets a sense of how everyone's playing everything in the scenes. And then everyone will go on their own and record their lines. And the way they record their lines is they record each line three times in a row in different indentations, like where they're just sort of like they're performing it in a slightly different way. Our directors then take all of those lines and they pick the take. And so it's like that's we do sort of like a backwards directing where the actors, you know, act multiple different ways and then the director has to choose the take to put into the final thing. And then those scenes then get sent to me. And then I do all the sound design with the sound effects and making it sound like everyone's in the same room together. That version of the scene then goes to Scott Tofty, our composer, who does a final mix of everything, adds the score, and then shoots the final episode back to me. And then I get it posted. So that's sort of the order of operations there.
That's why Zach Luna does that. We've poached your talent before. We've used Zach Luna for a couple of bits for Cosmic Geppetto. And first off, Zach's fantastic. I love Zach. I would have him on every week if I could figure out an excuse to get him on.
Me too.
I'll say, he's like, hey, can you do this? And I'll send him his lines. And he's like, yeah. And he gets it back to me real quick. And it's always three or four takes on each line. And it's so great because it's the same line, three different ways. And so there's always a take that fits perfect. Feel good knowing that your guys are taking what they're learning from working with you and spreading the wealth to other people. Or unless that ticks you off. It's like, No.
That's good. That's great.
Such an interesting challenge. When we've done the skits here, that's a little different because it's more personality. It's like, okay, it's based on the personalities of the show. And not everyone necessarily has the same level of acting ability, nor should they. But we make it work. And then also people don't have the same quality of recording equipment.
Yeah. No, I mean, that's the biggest issue is that actors aren't always the best. Cause that's the thing with this show too, is they're all voice actors because they're doing voice work, but they're not predominantly voice actors. Most of the people on the show, there's only a handful. And then like all of our supporting cast, like our extras and things, the little like one-liners there here and there are all voice actors, but most of the main cast are all actors who are doing Geek by Night in their spare time. And so they're not used to working in a voice actor capacity. So that's definitely one of the hardest things is walking through with them why something sounds bad because they don't have an ear for it. So they don't understand that like, see, when I can hear that you're in a big empty room, it sounds like you're existing in another universe compared to the other people in the scene. And it's stuff like that of just trying to explain to them why their recording sounds bad and how to fix it. Luckily, everyone's been doing a lot better this season versus previous seasons where it was a lot more inconsistent.
Obviously, I imagine I'm going to go completely crazy here and say if you had the opportunity and the budget and the opportunity, you would love to do it as a TV show.
Oh, yeah.
Is it just you had this great idea and this is the best format for it, or is it something that you always had wanted to try, this sort of radio play?
So originally Geek by Night, I conceived of Geek by Night I think in 2007 when I originally wrote the pilot of the original series. It was going to be a like a YouTube series, like a Guild type show. You know, I had heard of the Guild and I had watched the first episode and I thought, well, this is okay, but I don't relate to these characters because I don't play online video games. I think that was back in the Guild. I don't remember where the Guild started. 2007. Yeah, so that's right. That lines up. I think this is an interesting thing to do, but like, I don't relate to these people, but I do relate to comic book nerds. I wanted to do a show that was set in a comic book shop, but was, you know, similar in sort of tone to the Guild. So I wrote it like that, and we were going to produce it at a my local comic book shop, who it was closed 3 days a week and was just going to let us shoot in there on the closed days. And we were going to do this this thing. Eventually, we realized how much money it was going to cost to even do that. I kind of got discouraged and was like, I don't have money for that. I can't do this. We can't do this. One of the actors quit out of the blue. I decided to just sort of scrap the idea of doing it as that. At the time, there was an audio drama podcast called Buffy Between the Lines, which was a Buffy sort of fanfic podcast that was scripted with a full cast that was filling in the periods of time between seasons of Buffy. I think their first season took place between season 2 and 3. And so it was after Buffy left Sunnydale, but before she came back to Sunnydale. And so it was like what happened over the summer when Buffy wasn't there. And so they would do stuff like that. And I listened to that show and I thought, oh, this seems pretty cool. Like, I think I could do this. But I did feel like at the time that it was missing something, because I would find myself kind of confused a lot about what exactly was happening, because I didn't understand, like, some of the sound effects choices weren't clear and some of the dialogue felt like it wasn't doing a good enough job of, like, painting the picture. Then I got the audiobook for Bruce Campbell's second book, Make Love the Bruce Campbell Way, which had a fairly large cast. Not, you know, it was still mostly Bruce Campbell, but there were other actors in it. And it was Bruce Campbell playing himself, but also doing the narration. And then there were other actors who were interacting with him throughout the audiobook. I was like, oh, maybe we could do it like this. So then I rewrote the pilot as an audio drama with narration. And that was the first iteration of the show, which premiered in 2008, I think. That was what inspired it. It wasn't so much like, oh, I really always wanted to do an audio drama. It was more that I really wanted to tell the story and I wanted to find a way to do it. And that's why most of our actors come from that Buffy Between the Lines show, because I reached out to the people running that show and was like, hey, can I edit some scenes from your show so that I can, like, practice and see if I can do this? Also, I'm holding auditions for my own show. Could you spread it around your acting pool and see if any of them want to audition? And that's where I got Chris, who plays Gibson. That's where I got our narrator. Chris, who plays Gibson on the show, played Xander on that show. Brian, who is our narrator and one of the villains on the show, played Giles. And a few of the other actors also came from that show. Yeah, and it just sort of happened that way. It took off because, you know, in 2008, there weren't nearly as many podcasts as there are now. And so, you know, we had an astronomical number of listeners at the time. And so it was really worthwhile to do. And then it just sort of, we all got older and some of our actors got married and had kids. And, you know, we all just sort of lost focus and dropped the show. And then in 2015, I reached out to everybody to see if they would want to do a reboot of the show. Mostly everyone agreed to come back, and we sort of rebooted the show in a way that respected what came before, but was completely accessible to anyone, because none of that other stuff was in continuity. We would just sort of reference some of it in, like, vague ways, so that if you listened to the old show, it didn't feel like we were repeating ourselves.
When I talked with Bob Kestner about Immunities, he sort of said something similar, where he had a cool idea and finding the right place for it. Even the smallest budgeted micro show YouTube series can cost a lot of money just in equipment.
Yeah.
Because you'll be amazed how, without just proper miking, how bad something can sound.
Right.
And that stuff isn't cheap. Yes, it was a script that I had written that it had been submitted to the Baltimore Playwrights Festival. Some scenes from it were done, but it sort of had it laying around, and I realized because it's sort of a one-set show, it would work well as a radio play. And then we ended our current madness and people that I know that work for a local dinner theater had nothing to do. So I was like, well, here's a chance. It's a script that I've had laying around that I've always toyed around with doing it as its own thing. And you have people in the dinner theater had a line of promotion because they're very good at promoting. And they had actors who they like to work with who just were sort of sitting around not being able to be creative. It's like, okay, let's do this. So that's how that sort of happened. But what really amazes me, and I'm a big fan of yours, Scott, I think that you always do really good work, and the level of professionalism and creativity that you have is always really impressive. But what really impresses me is, again, these aren't short episodes. There's a lot of big ideas. Just the most recent episode, there was a lot of humor. There was some pathos. There's also a little bit of, I don't know if it can go full breaking the fourth wall, but there was a little bit of like a wink to the audience, which I love. It's just such a big production that is done so well. Like I say, I find it so impressive, even more so now that I know I have like a small idea what goes into it.
Yeah. I mean, I appreciate you saying that. It's a lot of hard work, but I'm extremely proud of it. Proud of everyone's work on the show. I know that it's a crazy thing that we do, but I'm just like, I guess I'm just so in it that I don't realize from the outside probably what it seems like when other people listen to it. I'm like going into each scene. I mean, the writing is one thing, and then when I do the sound design, you know, I'm just sort of going into each scene, kind of figuring it out as I go along a lot of the time, and just trying to, I don't know, get the scene to sound the way that I picture it in my head and what that requires, I guess. And just sort of figuring that out. It's like putting a puzzle together. And yeah, it's a lot of work. I don't think we would have been able to do it this year if I hadn't been unemployed all year. So this has been sort of my full-time job this year. And it's been a lot of fun. It's been like the main redeeming thing that I've had this year.
So you have one more episode that's going to come out middle of December.
Right.
And then you're taking a break, and you're going to have your final batch of episodes. Do you know how many episodes that will be?
We have a planned number, but I'm not prepared to say what it is yet because that could change because we're not done writing it. We have a basic idea, but I'm guessing it's going to be somewhere in the ballpark of 4 to 6 episodes.
How long have you had sort of the end game planned out? Is it more of a rough sketch?
No, it's fairly planned out. I always leave wiggle room for things to change if they need to change, but it's fairly planned out. It was not meant to end now. It was meant to be an ongoing show, but unfortunately, we haven't really gotten the financial support behind it or really even the listener support, which I guess I understand. It seems that in the audio drama, like podcast, scripted narrative podcast circles, it seems that the most popular shows tend to be horror shows or science fiction shows, like hard sci-fi shows, or things like Welcome to Night Vale, where it's like a scripted narrative show, but it's in a weird format where it's like almost found footage, sort of like whatever the podcast equivalent of that is. To have a show that is probably has more in common with like Buffy the Vampire Slayer than it does with any other audio drama, I think it's a hard sell for people because they don't really, I don't think they really get it. And it's hard to get people to listen to things. I have friends that I've had since we relaunched the show, and they've never listened to the show because they don't get it and they're not going to do it. So it's difficult. It's a hard ask. And I know that if they listen to it, they would like it, but it's hard. It's hard to get people to listen to a thing. And it's so much work that we've just sort of decided to move on from it, but we didn't want to move on from it without giving it an ending. So we sort of conceived of an ending of this version of the show so that we can move on to other things next year.
Are there any products in this genre that you enjoy that you have been listening to?
There's a few. One of the issues, of course, is that I'm too busy making my own show to listen to a lot of those other shows, which is difficult. But one that I do have on my player right now is a show that's called Prototype World of Tomorrow. It's a show about like what if Walt Disney's Epcot had actually gotten made, which was his experimental prototype City of Tomorrow, where people would actually like live and work. And what if that had actually gotten made and now it's the year 2020, people are living there and then a murder happens. The city in the show is called Progress. And so it says murder. So like the first season of the show is called Murder in Progress, which is fun. So that's the only one that I've got that I'm listening to right now. But I look forward to at the end of the road of Geek by Night, going back and listening to some other stuff, if for no other reason than just sort of build some relationships with some of the creators that I end up really respecting.
One that I listened to the first handful of episodes to was Voyage to the Stars. That had Felicia Day from The Guild and Buffy the Vampire Slayer, and Janet Varney, whom I'm a fan of.
Voice of Korra, right?
Yes, yes. She was also in a pretty good show, Stan vs. Evil.
Oh, yeah, sure. Yeah.
I like her a lot. A science fiction comedy, so it's poking some fun at Star Trek and its conventions, but it was heavily improvised.
Okay, yeah.
It was a lot easier to be impressed by than it was to like.
Mm, sure. Yeah.
Obviously, these were really talented people thinking on their feet. I'm always wildly impressed by improvisation, but when it's then supposed to be a serialized story, it can be a bit of a jumble. And after five or six episodes, I was like, okay, I get it. And it did make me laugh. I think there's a thing that I like and something that I like by Geek by Night where I like to see the chess pieces move around. When you're doing improvised stuff like that, it's not chess pieces. It's definitely checkers at best.
Yeah, sure, sure. Oh, another one that I do want to mention because I forgot about it, but I listen to this show religiously. It's not on the air anymore, but it's all out, so you can listen to it. It was a show called The Thrilling Adventure Hour. I loved that show to pieces. It was a an hour of audio drama, not really sketches. They're like ongoing serials. And so you have one that is about a sheriff on Mars, one about a married couple who investigate paranormal stuff, and then a third one in the middle that could be, you know, whatever that week. There's like a few recurring segments that they would sort of cycle through in that third spot. And it's a comedy show. And so like both, all of the shows are really, really funny, and it's done in sort of a old radio play style and has a great cast. Beyond Belief was the name of the married couple one that had Paul F. Tompkins as his name was Frank Doyle, and then Padgett Brewster as Sadie Doyle. That's probably my favorite one of the bunch. And then there was, do you know who Mark Evan Jackson is?
I'm not sure that I do.
He's in a lot of sitcoms. He's got red hair. He usually plays like an uptight guy. He was in The Good Place, and he plays...
Oh, he's fantastic. I just looked him up. He's also been on Brooklyn Nine-Nine.
Yes. Yeah, and so he plays the sheriff on Mars. And so it's a phenomenal show. It's probably one of my favorite podcasts of all time. It slipped my mind because it hasn't been on the air in a few years. They used to go and record it monthly. And so they would release like the monthly live episode that they would do in like chunks for each of the individual segments over the course of the month. And yeah, it was like one of my favorite things. It's so, so good.
Mark Evan Jackson strikes me as one of those actors people aren't going to realize how wonderful he is probably for another 10 years. I'm thinking of actors like Eugene Levy and Fred Willard, really funny guys who, because they're not lead actors, they end up doing a lot of crap because, you know, there's a lot of crap out there. And if you need to pay the bills, you're going to do some crap.
Exactly.
And sometimes you can't get the stink of the bad stuff off of you. But then when given anything even mediocre, he's fantastic.
Yeah, very true.
Fred Willard, I want to say he was like in his 60s when all of a sudden general people realized, oh my God, he is a wonderful and he's a treasure Mark Evan Jackson is an actor like that. And of course, I'm saying this, I didn't even know his name until you mentioned it, but I've always liked him because he was great on a couple episodes of Parks and Rec. And then I think he gets sort of in that sort of a repertory group of the producers, the shared producers between that and Good Place and Brooklyn Nine-Nine. I'm interested because you mentioned how horror, a lot of popular pieces in the genre are horror. You know, you're doing some superhero comedy. The show I've done is, if it's going to be categorized as anything, it'd be sort of like a rom-com. What do you think is the best? I don't even see horror as great for this format.
Yeah, but it's what people listen to. Because I don't disagree. I have never heard a horror audio drama that I've particularly cared for. That doesn't mean that they're not good at what they do. It's just like whatever they're doing isn't for me, which is fine. It obviously works because the download numbers say otherwise. What they're doing is working, and what we're doing, I guess people just aren't interested in. I don't know. I don't know if people just don't listen to this format for comedy. My focus on Geek by Night has always been the characters and making sure that the characters and their relationships are strong. If you can sell the characters to the audience, you can make them care about them, then they're going to care about anything that happens to them. So then you can start doing weirder plot things and things because everyone is going to be hooked on the characters. It seems to me that for most people in most listeners in the audio drama sphere, the reverse is what people want, which is they're more interested in plot. It's interesting because I will get a lot of I've seen some negative reviews of the show. There really aren't many, which is I'm very, very grateful for. But I've run across a few, like on Reddit and things like that, and it's always the same critique, which is they're like, well, this plot, there's nothing logical about this plot. Why would this character do this? And I'm like, did you listen to the episode? Because the character explained exactly why they were doing it and justified it because of the type of person that they are. But they don't care about that. They want it to make sense.
That's not what I would do.
Right. Exactly. Exactly. And I think that a lot of audio drama listeners, that's actually what they're in it for, is like these sort of cold stories. There's definitely a place for those. Lots of people like cold stories. I mean, if they didn't, Nolan wouldn't be as big of a director as he is. One of the coldest, most like logical directors I've ever seen. And he's very good at it. It's just not where my creative juices lie. And I am very grateful for all the people that my show connects with. Does connect with a lot of people. The people who listen to it and love it at a level that I'm always shocked by. It's getting people to listen to it when it's not the kind of audio drama they're used to, has been the most difficult thing. Really, I think that our target audience is probably not people who listen to audio drama, but people who are trying an audio drama for the first time having watched television. That's more of our target audience, because that's one of the things too that we would constantly get hit by, is people being like, these episodes are too long. I'm like, but you watch TV episodes that are this long. Why is it? Because it's an audio drama. It needs to be like under 15 minutes. That is a very weird critique to have as well. But again, I think it's the difference between more religious audio drama listeners, you know, people who listen to a lot of audio drama, versus I think people who would really like our show, which is people who have never listened to audio drama before and just like good TV shows.
Is this a format or an idiom that you're planning on going back to? Or are you going to take a back seat to that and, you know, go back to your minute by minute world? Or
No, I am retired from movies by minute, sir. I am never going back.
I remember you talking about hanging up your spurs.
Yeah. No, I'm done. I did 9 seasons, actually soon to be 10 seasons, because we technically did all of Scott Pilgrim minute by minute on our Patreon. So 10 seasons of movies by minute shows. That's enough. I'm good. I'm done. Yeah, actually, interesting thing about all of that. So Dueling Genre is actually in the process of a kind of transition where we are changing the way we do things in kind of a major way, sort of creatively and I guess professionally. What we are doing is in January, we're going to have a sort of like live announcement thing where we are going to outline what we're calling Dueling Genre Phase 2. And we're gonna walk through what all of our new podcasts are, because all of our Movies by Minute shows have sort of all ended in various ways. So we are planning on doing this sort of reboot of the network post Movies by Minute, as we talk about what all of our new shows are and things like that. And one of those is definitely a scripted narrative thing. I can't talk about what that thing is yet, because I want to save it for the announcement. But it is something that Nick and I are really excited about, and everybody at Dueling Genre seems to be really excited about. But it's going to be kind of a different thing from Geek by Night, and it's going to be its own thing, and it's going to be in a format that is going to allow for change often, like creative change. We're really excited about that. As far as all of the other shows, we're announcing a whole slate of shows, like Nick and I's new show and lots of other things. I think we're announcing, I want to say, 7 new shows in January. So we're really excited about those. And we're calling it Dueling Genre Phase 2, and there's going to be like a site refresh. There's going to be a new logo. It's going to be a brand new Dueling Genre.
Very cool. That's exciting and I look forward to hearing about that. I've always been, and I've called Dueling Genre the gold standard in podcast world. Just the quality, the oversight, the imagination, it's always been real impressive. And I've always enjoyed talking to you about it.
Oh, thank you.
Not being able to do as much as we would like. What pop culture stuff have you been enjoying lately?
Well, I've been making my way through Cobra Kai. That's been a lot of fun. That show is so much better than it has any right to be. And definitely highly recommend it. I'm really excited about season 3. I think I'm going to end up finishing season 2 sort of just before season 3 premieres next month. So I'm definitely looking forward to that. Really, really good series. Currently watching The Crown, the new season of The Crown, because that's a show that sort of scratches my Mad Men itch that I've had since that show ended. I think it has a kind of a similar tone of lots of people talking in rooms about very serious things, but really well. And it's been kind of scratching that itch for me, so I've been really enjoying that. I also have been rewatching The Good Fight, a CBS All Access series, which I think is going to soon be a Paramount Plus series. I think that's what they're renaming their streaming service.
That's the sequel to The Good Wife.
Yes, right. The Good Wife being one of my favorite shows of all time. My significant other wanted to try a show out that was like a different vibe than what we normally watch. And so I was like, well, we should watch this. And so we watched The Good Fight, and she loves it, which is really nice, because it is one of my favorite shows on air right now. Also, from the creators of The Good Wife and The Good Fight, they also created that show Evil that just popped up on Netflix in October. Really, really good show. It is also a CBS show, but it doesn't feel like a CBS procedural in any way. It's really, really cool. It's about the church sort of investigating like whether demons exist and like possessions are real and things like that, with a team of people that involves a priest played by Mike Coulter, the actor who played Luke Cage, and then a skeptic, and then a woman who is a psychiatrist to sort of figure out if they're possessed or just mentally ill. Excellent show that has procedural elements, but is also highly serialized in a way that's really satisfying. So those would be the ones that I'd probably recommend right now.
Coulter's fantastic.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
He was great as Luke Cage, and he was a wonderful recurring character on The Good Wife.
Yes, he was. Yeah.
I watched the first few episodes of Cobra Kai, and while I understood where it was going, and I might revisit it again, I had a tough time connecting to it. But it's one of those shows where it's like, I could tell it wasn't bad. We all can't watch everything.
Yeah, yeah, for sure.
One show that I did watch, although I had heard some buzz that it was going to be good, but my cable service gives me free Peacock Network.
Oh, yeah.
There was the Saved by the Bell reboot, which was very funny. I actually laughed out loud.
I haven't had a chance to watch this yet. I'm excited to... I think I'm planning on watching it between finishing Cobra Kai and Cobra Kai season 3 coming out, because it seems like it's kind of in similar vein in terms of like rebooting an old thing in a new way.
It's very smart. It's very funny. It's well written. You can tell the writers have an affection for the original show. So they do a lot of, okay, that's a joke that you only get if you watched the original show. Now, I was not a fan of Saved by the Bell because it was pretty stupid.
It was a kid's show. I watched it all the time growing up, but I never thought it was good. I always just sort of, I don't know what it was about those characters that I liked enjoyed watching, but for some reason I did when I was a kid.
They cast it well.
Yeah.
Say what you will about all of them, but Mark Paul Gosselaar has gone on and done good work. He's continued to get cast and stuff. He definitely has presence and charisma, and there's something watchable about him. Mario Lopez, Tiffany Thiessen, Elizabeth Berkley, make all the jokes you want about how bad Showgirls was, and she still had enough presence, charisma, looks, whatever it is, where they decided to build this movie around her. There's something watchable about all these people. To their credit, they all come on this new show, and I'm not spoiling anything, they've shown them in the ads for it, where they show up a couple episodes, and they're funny, and they take some fun jabs at themselves and at the show. It's like, oh, this actually made me laugh. Even shows that I like, in comedies I do like, I don't often laugh out loud.
Sure.
So it's like, oh, okay, pretty good.
Yeah, that's great.
All right, so Scott, where can people find out, keep up on you, and keep up on Dueling Genre?
You can follow me on Twitter if you're on Twitter. I'm at Scott Carelli. I'm at Scott Carelli pretty much on all the social medias. But you can do the same thing with Dueling Genre if you want. All of this is updating pretty soon, and we're pretty excited about it. Where we've also got some exclusive Patreon content that we're starting next year that we're really, really excited about. That's going to be sort of like an ongoing kind of entertainment news show called Dueling Genre Tonight. And we're going to be doing that over on our Patreon at duelinggenre.com/support. So yeah, we're excited about all of the stuff that we've got coming up. More than anything, though, I'm just here to promote Geek by Night. So please, 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 if you haven't checked out Geek by Night, check it out, because I think you'll like it.
Really good stuff. Really fun. I think our audience will like it. Give a subscribe. Give a listen. And there's a whole bunch of episodes that you can listen to because, quite frankly, it's not like we're doing anything else. All right, Scott, this has been amazing as always. And before you know it, I'll be reaching out again so we can talk about summer movies. Although, quite frankly, it's just stuff that we've talked about before, 90%. But we'll figure out something to talk about.
Thanks, Brad.
That wraps episode 215. Big thanks to Scott Carelli. He is one of my favorite guests, and I cannot express enough how impressed I am with the work being done at Dueling Genre Productions. Geek by Night is fantastic. Also, big thanks to Katie May. She has been an all-star this year. Next time on the Cosmic Geppetto Podcast, new friend Marty Jurek is making damn cool music and is going to talk about it. Till then, in the words of Jarv Harden,
see you in the funny pages.
Broke up with my boyfriend to go out with my girlfriend. 'Cause love is like that. 'Cause love is like that.
Subscribe to the Cosmic Geppetto Podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, or wherever quality podcasts can be found. Rate and review us while there. Follow us on Twitter at Cosmic Gpod, and we will follow you back. Unless you're a jerk, we don't follow jerks. Like us on Facebook at facebook.com/Cosmic Geppetto. We love hearing your ideas for upcoming episodes. Email us at cosmicgeppetto@comcast.net.
Make love the Bruce Campbell way.
But I